in its silver anniversary season, the Professional Bowlers Tour. Today from Kansas City, $40,000 King Louie Open. Let's meet today's outstanding field of finalists. He won his first title here in 1980. The president of the Professional Bowlers Association, Ernie Schlegel. Making his second TV appearance this year, in fourth place, Dave Husted. Call the King Louie Open lucky for Mike Jasnau, whose only two television finals have been here. He bowled a 300 game earlier this week, and a win today would make Pete Weber the youngest player in PBA history to win 10 titles. And in first place, leading the tournament for the first time ever, a win today would qualify him for the Firestone, Jimmy Pritts, Jr. That's our field for the King Louie Open today on the Professional Bowlers Tour. Ah, yes, for the 21st consecutive year, we've come to this indelible area with indelible Midwestern spirit. I'm talking about Overland Park, Kansas, a suburb of Kansas City itself. This is an enthusiastic crowd here, and I think you will be too. Now that you've met the five finalists, they are tremendous bowlers, all stylists, all right-handers, and all want the $24,000 first prize check. Only one can get it. In the next 90 minutes, you'll know the winner. This starts an exciting afternoon on ABC and sports. Wide World follows, which includes the men's World Cup downhill skiing from the site of the 1988 Winter Olympic Games, Calgary. Plus, the United States going against the Soviet Union in amateur boxing. Our professional colleague was great this week. He finished ninth. I'm speaking of Nelson Burton Jr. He is making a step closer to the finals. Won't be long, Bo.
Well, you're right, Chris. After 9 weeks, I'm finally bowling myself into shape, and this week I did have a pretty good week. I averaged better than 220 and still just snuck out ninth place. So you can see what kind of scoring we expect today. The lanes have been red hot all week long. As Chris said, there was a 300 bowled by Pete Weber. And obviously, the championship round features five top players, but different styles. Ernie Schlegel throws the ball as straight as any of you league bowlers. You'll like him. And of course, Pete Weber with the big hooks, always exciting. But I think the thing to watch is the King Louie Corporation changed these lanes, this whole building and whole plant, 2 years ago. Now, last year, the players had a lot of trouble adjusting to the lanes. We had a very low-scoring championship round. If you recall, a player won with two open frames, finishing the ninth and tenth frames with open and still won, Mark Baker. Today, that will all change. I expect a lot of strikes. We have a tough field. And Chris, we're ready for action.
All right, thank you, Bo. And here we do go at it. Our first match in the King Louie. There you see David Husted, who will watch the oldest member in the field, Ernie Schlegel, at 43, president of the PBA, shooting first. He won this championship in 1980, defeating, of all people, Nelson Burton Jr. First stroke on the left lane. Leaving the 10 pin, another capacity crowd here, watching along with you this first match. The winner of it will meet Mike Jasnau of Wichita, Kansas, then the exciting Pete Weber, and then the tournament leader, Jimmy Pritts, Jr.
Ernie Schlegel, a very deliberate player, but he's much quicker than he used to be, Chris, and I think he learned that when he started becoming a winner 5 years ago.
All right, he marks. And of course, now being president of your association, Bo, he has to set a good example, right?
Well, that's very true, and obviously he's doing a good job. And here's a player who's been doing a good job ever since he came on the tour, David Husted.
And the man who was fifth right here a year ago, the United States Open champion in 1982 with a big strike.
Chris, the championship pair, 19 and 20 here at King Louie West in Overland Park, which is just west of Kansas City. As you see the style of David Husted, that high backswing, very similar to Pete Weber's. Husted stays down with the ball very well, comes through with it. You just can't throw it any better than that. Obviously, starting with a strike, looking for a first double.
And he left the seven pin on the left lane. Milwaukee, Oregon is his hometown. Had a couple of big years, the one in 1982, 102,000, just second to Earl Anthony, and then last year, 108,000. Tremendous athlete.
Mm-hmm.
quickly on the approach, Chris. I think that's something that we all can learn. Some of the league bowlers that are very slow, if they'll just meet the man they follow coming off the approach, you'll always speed up the action.
Oh, he loved that. Did a little twist. 43-year-old Ernie Schlegel.
The profile of Ernie Schlegel, five-step delivery, is learned in the old school. Back when they had lacquer lanes, didn't hook very much. Ernie obviously doesn't throw the big hook, keeps his fingers directly behind the ball, head steady on the target, good uplift and follow through, and obviously a great result. It's an even match through two frames.
I love that double. And that puts him out there to a 10-10 lead over his opponent, David Husted. Five titles to his credit, Ernie Schlegel with four. Here's a replay.
This is what's known as drilling all 10 pins. Schlegel hits high in the pocket. The four pin drives right into the seven. He has the early lead.
I hit, leaving only the 10.
David on the championship pair. The thing he has to work with is the left-hand lane breaks quite a bit, lane 19. The right-hand lane, lane 20, is pretty straight, and the players have to play a down and in line, which I would say favors Ernie Schlegel in this match. Once again, he avoids the 4-7-10 split. Easy spare.
We asked David this question. Did he learn a lesson from last week when he had a chance to make the field and didn't?
Well, last week I just came out too complacent. This week I tried to come out a little more aggressive. Things worked out real good. I'm going to carry that over in today and hopefully win the tournament.
And 2 weeks ago, of course, he was in the finals of the True Value Open. All but the seven.
Houston gets a pretty good break off, avoiding the 4-7-9. The head pin actually does a lot of the work as the ball goes straight back. The head pin goes around and comes back over, knocking out the four, doesn't quite catch the seven. Easy spare for Houston. He will trail by 12.
This is our first match of the King Louie Open. More coming up. It's a very efficient establishment here in Overland Park, Kansas, in our first match. After four, our winner will receive $24,000. 13 for second, 8 third, 4th, 6th, and the loser of our first game, which is now underway, will receive 5. Ernie Schlegel is leading by 12. He has a double up, shooting in the 4th frame. Big shot. He left the 2-4.
Ernie had good accuracy on that shot, but his thumb was over the top of the ball. As we talk about the championship pair, 19 and 20 here at King Louis, 32 lanes. The left-hand lane obviously hooks a lot more. If you've seen a number of shots go up high, the right-hand lane much, much tighter. The ball doesn't finish as much. Actually favors Ernie Schlegel.
Those, we often point out, people with some sort of handicaps can enjoy this as a recreation. Of course, his eyesight, he has to make big adjustments, doesn't he?
Well, Ernie off and on has had trouble with his eyesight. His left eye has some problems with, but he's solved most of those problems. As you see the line, Ernie plays at the 2-4 spare across the second arrow, getting a good line at the 2-4, converts it perfectly, leads by 10 pins through four frames.
All right, come on.
And again, it's the seventh. He somewhat happy with that as we look at Kathy, his wife, his manager, his friend, and his big love.
Once again, the championship here, the weights of pins we're using this week are 3-pound 7 and 3-pound 8-ounce pins. That's about the average of what we use on a Pro Bowlers Tour, so we shouldn't see anything much different in the pin action than we've seen in other weeks.
Who just got it? That should ease some tension here, as Dave Husted is back up, spare working, shooting in the fifth frame, trailing by only 9.
Ooh. He Husted bowling a very good game so far, but he doesn't have just quite the right shot. Now watch the head pin go to the sideboard here, and it'll take out the seven pin, but doesn't quite take out the four. Now what happens is that when you have a nice hook ball like Husted rolls, when the lane's real slick, he must start the ball up to the pocket or it won't come up, and it just doesn't what we call hold there, and he always is fighting the high hit.
And again, a very thin hit on that single pin, but continuing to mark and trailing by 10, Dave Husted.
David has bowled well in the 5 or 6 years he's been on the tour, winning the U.S. Open, and has obviously had some tremendous training. As you see, the fingertip grip used by David held very low. He's had great training from his dad, Champ Husted, an excellent bowler in his own right.
And this 26-year-old left the 23rd television appearance for David.
Here's the hit that David has to have. He hits in the 1-3 zone. Now watch the 5-pin. This pin, it goes over and just misses the 7. A power player like Husted must carry this to be effective. There the ball hits the 1-3. Watch the action of the 5. He blows it right in front of the 7.
So Schlegel is up, leading by 11 with his pair working, shooting in the 6th frame. This establishment has some interesting facts. The winner of the first match in the tournament over the years has won 7 times in 20 years. Beautiful, beautiful form. The president of the PBA, Ernie Schlegel, we asked him what his goals are.
Well, what I'd like to see is the whole industry come together to help the professional bowlers make a living. And what I'm talking about is hopefully by the time I leave office, we'd be on the road to $25 million.
And obviously, Chris, he means $25 million a year. A week wouldn't be too bad, but I feel a lot of people would be changing occupations at that rate.
Right.
Right now, the PBA is bowling from upwards of $5 to $6 million a year. Not too bad.
Big double for Ernie Schlegel. We're in Overland Park, Kansas.
And you see a discrepancy in the averages between Husted and Schlegel. Husted averaged 239, Schlegel 213 on the championship pair. But Husted, what we said, got him at night.
Well, only his second strike in 7 frames.
Chris, I spoke with David earlier, and he liked the lanes when they started hooking quite a bit, and that was in the evening, as most bowling centers start hooking a lot more in the evening. Ernie Schlegel also bowled in the evening. He doesn't like them in the evening, but right now it's early afternoon. I say the lane condition favors Schlegel. Husted needs this strike, though, to cut his lead down to just 11 pins.
The man that won twice in 1986, his biggest year ever. This is the path of that last shot.
You'll see David Husted right inside the second arrow, about the 11th board, straightens the ball out. A very talented young man drives the 1-3 rack into the 4 and 7, and he has got some pressure on Schlegel. Now it's up to Schlegel to respond. A good match game bowler, Schlegel needs this strike to retain his 21-pin lead.
And that long-lasting follow-through and the little dance step at the line, he knew that the three-bagger was important. 21-pin lead.
People may ask why a certain style favors a different player. Here you see Schlegel's ball driving the five-pin, the head pin, the sideboard, taking out the 4-5-7. When lanes are slick and you can't break the ball very much, Schlegel can afford to point the ball right at the head pin. So no matter where he throws it, unless he completely misses, he's going to hit around the pocket. A hook ball player like Husted has to give it room and get plenty on it just to get it back. So Schlegel in the driver's seat can open up a 31-pin lead here in the 9th frame.
No!
Didn't get the 4-pin.
Well, Schlegel really wanting that shot to put a lot of pressure on David Husted. Sends the ball high and avoids the 4-9 split, gets an easy spare to shoot at the 4-pin, with this barrel, he'll maintain his 20-pin lead, and he'll be going at a 226 pace through nine frames. David Husted still has room for 236.
Now, Husted back up. Winner of this game will meet Mike Jasnau, a Wichita State University collegiate bowler, originally from New York State.
The biggest frame of the match, a must shot for Husted.
The 5-8 on the right lane.
Husted looks back and he says, boy, I really threw that ball well. And what happened? He throws that big hook ball and the ball does not finish in the oil. Now here you see Husted from behind. He gets down and he throws a good lift on the ball right around the second arrow. He's saying, come on, hook ball. It doesn't make it. He leaves the 5-8 spare.
Well done. David and his wife, Michelle, expecting their first child in 2 months. They're great parents.
The prospects for David Husted to keep going in today's championship round lie in this frame. He must throw two strikes to have any chance at winning the match. If he doesn't strike on this ball, Schlegel will be the winner. He's still in it.
Tremendous competition over the years here at the King Louie Lanes.
A determined look on David Husted. I like it. He's a great winner. He just needs to be a little more aggressive. Such a nice guy. Sometimes he doesn't act tough out here. He has so far today. But he needs this strike to have any chance of winning the match.
Left the two pin on the left lane.
Just not to be for David Husted. The head pin goes to the sideboard, and it normally will take out the two pin. That's this pin right here in the center. But when the ball hits that light, it doesn't have room to use it.
Now Schlegel on the right lane. 10th frame, spare in the ninth.
Winner, Chris.
Yes, he needed five to win. Leaves four, and Ernie Schlegel from the number five position moves one step ahead. You'll meet Mark Jasnau in the next match here in Kansas City. A professional bowler's tour is brought. The 1972 King Louie Open was a thriller, incredibly close. A match between Larry Laub and Max Jensen coming down to the final frames.
Very important count.
We got all of them. 237 for Max Jensen in his very first television appearance.
He needs at least nine. All right, Chris, he got the nine. Now he can still win.
Frustrated, Jensen watched as Laub covered the 10 pin for his spare, and now the shot.
Chris, we talk about emotion. He's drained. If he's anything more than one standing, Max Jensen is the winner.
Max is not even looking. Turns away from the lane.
He balls.
He rolled it good, Chris.
A clutch performance by Larry Laub, defeating Max Jensen 238 to 237. Ernie Schlegel with six strikes at 222. Strike on his last ball defeated Husted 222 to 204. Now 43-year-old Schlegel against 24-year-old Mike Jasnau. And Ernie trying to stay loose.
Well, Chris, in that 1972 Remember When, Ernie Schlegel bowled in the tournament. Mike Jasnau, his opponent, was just 9 years old. So obviously the experience goes with Schlegel, but enjoy this young man Jasnau's game because you'll see a lot more of him. Okay, Schlegel, first shot, second game.
All right. And there is a replay.
You see the line of Schlegel playing out around the first arrow. Remember, David Husted was playing around the second arrow to accommodate that big hook he rolls. Schlegel has the perfect angle. Now here's Jasnau. Throws the medium-sized hook. He'll play right in between.
And a graduate of Wichita State University, where he got a degree in business management, Mike Jasnau did a super job.
Watch the action of the 6-pin right here on the right-hand part of your screen as it just bumps out the 10-pin. That's the power of Jasnau. He has a fine blend of accuracy with medium hook and good wrist action for power. Let's see how he handles this left-hand lane that gave Husted so much trouble.
So he'll have a shot at the 7-pin coming up.
Really? Boy, he should be disappointed in that shot because he hits right in the 1-3 zone, Chris. The ball, the 5-pin, once again, comes over and gets caught up over in the left-hand corner. A hit that was kind of the downfall of David Husted.
Mike Jasnau, who finished fourth here in the King Louis Championship just a year ago. And here is the 1980 winner of this event. Previous winners repeat here. Mark Roth has won it three times. George Pappas and Don Janello twice each. So with one, this is the 43-year-old that would like to make it two. Ten pin.
If Schlegel can carry that hit, and he thought he might carry it, he would be almost unstoppable because he pulled that ball slightly. Now watch the action of the 6-pin. Now it'll be elevated up and over the 10-pin. Players have a legitimate complaint, you league bowlers, when you leave one like that.
Schlegel's last victory came in the 1985 Miller Lite Open when he beat Pete Weber. And the winner of our second match will face that same Pete Weber.
And that was one of those matches in the beginning of the Miller Lite Slam where if Pete Weber had won that Miller Lite tournament, he would have had a chance at $1 million. Ernie never gave him a chance as he digs his fingers into those finger holes, fingertip grip. He uses those white grippers and thumb grip that he is so popular with. Match is all even, third frame.
Oh, two strikes on that left lane now for Ernie Schlegel. And Mike is back up. He began yesterday here in 12th position. It was a close battle right down to the wire to get the final five.
Watch the eyes of Jazz now. Sets him on his target, never moves him.
Oh, a high hit, nine went, and so did the three.
Well, he got a good break there because as you see Jasnau's style, he takes what we call a 4.5 step delivery, good push away, and does not quite stay down with his shot. He gets down low here and then starts raising up with that right arm a little early. See the elbow bend, and he leaves the 3-6-9-10. And what had happened is the machine knocked over the 3-pin. The 9-pin fell out, and right now we're waiting for someone from the machine area to reset the 3-pin. So he'll have the 3-6-10 to shoot.
All right.
Remember, if a machine aids in the pinfall, it must be reset. The pin does not count.
And it's that pin that was replaced that he missed. Trails by 14.
Obviously disappointed. Last year after the Miller Lite Championship, I took Mike Jasnau out to dinner and just kind of picked his brain a little bit, Chris. He's just a real nice young man, and he has a great future out here, but I think he needs to be a little more aggressive when he comes up there and throws for the big money.
A moment ago, we saw her sister, his sister, Jacqueline DiBiase. So we'll have more of the second match, but first this. Part for the Miller Mini Slam. Walter Ray Williams and Tom Milton have a chance for $50,000. One of the two, if they can win a week from today.
Ernie Schlegel leads by 14, can extend it to 24, as I believe he just started a little too quickly, Chris, and just slipped on the approach, so.
Happens to me all the time.
Ernie is a very experienced player, as you see what's following us, Chris, the Downhill Cup from Calgary, Alberta, and of course, one of the great rivalries in amateur boxing, the United States versus USSR.
And a little less than a year from now, ABC Sports will be in Calgary for the Winter Olympic Games.
Once again, here's Ernie. Strike working, leads by 14.
And he has this to contend with, the 1-2-10.
Something to watch with Ernie Schlegel. Now watch the position of the ball as it just slides right by the head pin. And what he has to do is take this one pin and two pin and throw it over here towards the 10 pin. It obviously knocks down the remaining seven pins. So it's still called a spare to shoot even though the pins are separated if the head pin is standing. Very deliberate player. Schlegel has slowed down even more. Could be hurting his game.
Setting the example as president of the PBA, Ernie Schlegel. Watch.
Here we go. There's the head pin right into the 10 pin. He knows it when it leaves his hand. Perfect.
Renewed adrenaline. You can count on it flowing in this 43-year-old after that stroke.
Whew. Every shot that Schlegel has had off the mark so far today has been because he tries to hook the ball. His mind says, turn the ball over. He turns it too quickly, and it slides by the head pin. Let's see what happens on this shot. There he goes, perfect in the pocket. Now, he really has the left-hand lane zero. Schlegel's been striking the first, third, and fifth frames. If he can hit the right-hand lane, he'll have no problem at all. Now, his opponents have had good success with the right-hand lane, but have struggled on the left-hand lane. So let's see if Jasnau can make the adjustment. Cut the lead of Schlegel's down to just four pins if he can strike here in the fifth.
And the game is on, our second match. Mike Jasnau, college graduate. We asked how his college background influenced him.
I was offered a partial scholarship to Wichita State, and that enabled me to bowl competitively in college, which made me ready for the PBA tour and also gave me a good chance to get a good education.
And Chris, a lot of the Wichita State students were down here rooting Mike on during the week, and some of them in the stands today. Here's a strike for the lead.
And the two-time All-American at Wichita State leaves the 10 pin on the left lane.
Obviously, he's going high on the head pin. He avoids any type of split as he twists what we call mushes the pins or pushes them back. He almost knocks the 10 pin out. But the story continues. The opponents of Ernie Schlegel, who throw the big hook ball, cannot strike on the left-hand lane.
Winner of this game will meet colorful Pete Weber, then Jimmy Pritts, the tournament leader.
Now for Schlegel to really dominate his opponents, he has to hit the right-hand lane. What he must do is not play the same type of shot he plays on the left-hand lane. He must just roll it very smoothly at the foul line, not try to hook it, let the speed, let the ball roll up to the pocket. Let's see what he does.
Leaving the 2-4-5.
Schlegel looking at his thumb, and he tops the ball. He's losing it on the side of his hand. You see the trajectory of Schlegel much farther out than the other players that are his opponents. He's out around the first arrow trying to get angled towards the pocket. But if Schlegel just let the ball roll from that position instead of trying to hook the ball up in the pocket, he'll be in great shape. Now he must convert this spare to maintain his lead.
An open frame for Ernie Schlegel.
Uncharacteristic of Ernie, as you see the ball slide by the 2, 4, and 5 pins, leaving the 4 pin. He has given a tremendous opening, and he just says, "Oh, Ernie, I can't believe you did that." Now watch to see if he keeps his hand behind the ball. All right, here's a good shot. Now, if he keeps his hand behind the ball, it'll roll up solid. If he doesn't, he'll have another errant shot. Much better there.
Catherine, his wife, flew all night to get here and cheer her husband on.
Ernie, who has been a steady player on the tour for going on almost 20 years now, except for a few times, and one of them was right here in this area where he broke his foot working on his motorhome, Chris, put him out for a little while, but he recovered from that.
All right. Only 7 pins separating these two professionals. In the lead, Jasnau.
When you want the rich...
Next week, North Olmsted, Ohio, followed by the PBA National Championship in Toledo.
Down to see Mike Ducat and the boys there at Imperial Lanes in Toledo. And Ernie Schlegel is up here in the 8th frame. While we were away, Jasnau struck in the 7th and 8th frame. He now has a 17-pin lead. Ernie's back is to the wall.
Come on, Ernie.
All right, a big strike in the 8th. And if you're wondering why you didn't see those... 2 strikes by Jasnau. We have a 90-minute time period, and when bowling is slow, we run behind, so we have to make up time by allowing them to bowl through.
And you don't take many shots when you throw it as well as Schlegel just threw that last shot. He struck in the 8th frame right now. He must keep his hand behind the ball, be patient, make another good shot. He will cut the lead of Jasnau's down to just 7 pins with a strike in the 9th.
Make them work!
He begged for that one at the line, but the 7 pin.
Ernie made the obvious adjustment for the 4 pin. He threw the ball a little bit harder. He thought it would just work right in there. The ball drives through the 1-3, hits the 5, but he doesn't have quite the power to get that 5 over into the 7 pin. He must convert this spare to have any chance to win the match.
He won the first match, if you just joined us, over David Husted, 222-204. 6 strikes en route to that win. Pete Werber will be up next. Bowling now, Mike Jasnau, originally from Fishkill, New York, where his mother Jacqueline is watching today. A 2-4-5.
Just did not finish the shot. He had Schlegel on the ropes. If he could have struck on that ball, Chris, he would have had a lock victory. Now the match is still up for grabs. Ernie Schlegel has a potential 198. That forces Mike Jasnau to make this spare and fill a good count in the 10th frame, another mark. Let's see what happens.
It's the practicing of Pete Weber next up, and then the tournament leader, Jimmy Pritts.
Jasnau must mark here in the 10th frame to lock up the match. He needs to fill 17 pins on the 2 balls. In other words, 7 on the first ball and a strike would do the trick to shut out Schlegel. Here's the low angle. Jasnau saves the best for last as he throws the ball wide in the 10th frame, uses that power and revolution, drives all 10 pins into the pit. He's in the driver's seat. He just needs to get 7 pins on 2 balls. Hardly ever a day goes by that a player could not get 7 pins on 2 balls. These are the best pros in the world. The match will be over on this shot.
Sure way to do it as Mike Jasnau eliminates Ernie Schlegel in our second match. We'll give you that final score when we return, but first, this message. Weber next. Now for our Old Spice Professional Bowlers Tour Tip of the Week. Nelson continues his series on practice. concentrating today on accuracy. Watch and listen. The Professional Bowlers Tour Tip of the Week is brought to you by Old Spice. Its subtle masculine fragrance is the classic scent of the American male.
Today's tip, our second in a four-part series on practice, involves accuracy. Whether it's bowling, baseball, golf, tennis, if you play it with a ball, accuracy is at a premium. Today I'm going to show you a little tip that all the pros use to improve their arm swing, to improve their control of the ball, and improve their touch with a bowling ball. And it's very simply this. When you bowl your one practice game, bowl your first two frames standing on the first dot, the third and fourth frames on the second dot, the fifth and sixth on the center dot, seventh and eighth over here on the fourth dot, and finally the ninth and tenth frames of your practice game on the last dot. I'll show you how this works. On my first frame, I threw the ball down there standing on the first dot, and I left the 6-10 spare. Now, normally, I would move to the left side of the lane, go across the lane over the third arrow to convert to 6-10. But in our practice game here, I must remain on the first dot to convert that 6-10. That makes me throw it down the outside line and throw a nice, straight, simple, accurate shot. Watch this. Playing the dot game teaches you speed, hand, and arm control, which translates into greater accuracy.
What kind of... Here in Overland Park, Kansas, a beautiful suburb of Kansas City itself. And two matches, Schlegel won the first 222-204. Jasnau now the victor over Schlegel, 212-188 with 8 strikes. All right, let's get an answer to a question that we asked of Bo.
This week's Ask Bo question is for senior citizens. A topic that keeps arising in the Ask Bo questions is simply this. I am a senior citizen, and I seem to be losing my accuracy and my pin action. Well, that's no surprise to me. I've dealt with senior citizens for years and years, and the problem is very simply this. As you get older, you cannot maintain the ball speed on that heavy bowling ball. So here's the answer. In order to keep up the ball speed and the good pin action, go to a lighter ball. That's the best solution. And if you have an Ask Bo question, write me at this address.
And that address, remember it. And ask Bo questions about bowling. He loves to give you the answer. Who will win our third match? Well, it's a battle between the young folks. 24-year-old Mike Jasnau, and to be 25 in August, Pete Weber. Jasnau, who eliminated Schlegel, shoots first.
Some sedated action in the first two matches. It'll pick up this match with Weber in there.
Mike got 8 strikes in his victory.
Chris, now, Mike Jasnau is the man to beat in this tournament. He looks so smooth, and if Pete Weber doesn't do the job, I think that he'll go all the way. Let's see what happens.
33rd television appearance for this 24-year-old. Didn't come up all the way, leaving the two pin.
As we set up the championship pair, remember with David Husted, when you send the ball wide on the right-hand lane, you can't hardly get it back. Once again, Pete Weber with that high profile sends it wide, and he leaves the two pin. He converts it.
Pete Weber has finished twice second this year. So he's looking for that first win. He is 3 on the money list, $76,075, thanks to a second place check in our first tournament of the year of $55,000. Good tempo. Everything worked smoothly for Weber.
Pete Weber, with all that power, gets the ball really wide on the left-hand lane. And this tremendous revolutions drives the ball right through the heart of the 1-3, the 5 over the 7, something that nobody's been able to do today. And now he'll give Jasnau something to think about. Let's see what happens with Mike.
Mike is zeroed in. native of Fishkill, New York, where he started bowling at a young age.
David Husted and Ernie Schlegel, the first two contestants to go down this week, were rolling the ball 17 to 18 miles an hour. Mike Jasnau came on in the last match. He rolled it about 20 miles an hour. If you see a fingertip grip, urethane bowling ball, index finger spread. Let's see if he can take a 20-pin lead.
10-pin on the left lane.
Jasnau will amp up that speed to almost 22 miles an hour as he crosses the lane to convert the 10-pin. Once again, the ball does not finish quite solid in the pocket, but he looks really sharp in the early going.
A double and a spare for Jasnau. A spare and a strike for Weber, who's up shooting in the third frame now. Take a one-pin lead with a strike here. The two-pin.
This is the key lane for Pete Weber. With that big hook, he sends it wide on the right-hand lane that doesn't finish quite as much, and no matter how much turn or power he puts on it, doesn't quite get the job done, and once again, he leaves the two-pin.
We asked Pete earlier why he has dropped out of a few tournaments recently.
Well, I've had a lot of wrist problems this year. In L.A., I had to withdraw from the finals because my wrist hurt so bad, and then I had to withdraw again in Peoria. But I've seen a doctor, and I'm getting electrical impulse treatments on it, and I'm back, and I'm ready to go.
He's ready now on the left lane, way to the right of center. Another 10-pin.
Pete, surprising that he can't carry the 10-pin with all that power, but once again, he reaches for another ball, a shinier ball, cut down the surface friction, cut down the hook. Obviously, all that you need is accuracy on the spares.
And with a lot of speed, Weber continues to mark in a very close match. 10 pins separating our two young pros.
On down to the $150,000 Miller Lite Open on ABC's Professional Bowlers Tour next Saturday.
This is a tournament leader, 27-year-old Jimmy Pritts Jr., a New Englander. He wants a win badly, but here are two young professionals that hope to take one away from him today. You're looking at a non-winner named Mike Jasnau. Has a 10-pin lead, spare working fourth frame. Three strikes and four frames for Mike.
Jasnau really has his act together. He's adjusted to the right-hand lane, cutting down the hook and using a shot about 20 miles an hour. That's faster than anybody's used on that lane. He seems to have solved the problem. Mike, who, once again, is from Wichita State University, has a good group and following down here, and he tells me he'll be in Wichita with David Husted tomorrow for a Big Brothers, Big Little Brothers charity tomorrow, Chris. So this man's got it all together.
And doubling to go out to a 20-pin lead, and Weber is back up with a spare working, shooting in the fifth frame, finished second overall behind his friend Jimmy Pritts Jr., the tournament leader, who will meet the winner of this game.
Let's see what kind of adjustment Weber makes. He's been light. Both shots here on the right-hand lane has left the two-pin. Let's see if he can adjust.
The 5-8.
And that looks like the lane that's going to give the big power players the problem. David Husted came by the announce booth, and he said that this was the problem lane, that the lane gets slicker and slicker as you bowl. The big hook will not come back, and as you see the swing of Pete Weber, watch the wrist action. See that big turn over the second arrow, but not enough to get it back to hit solid in the pocket. Now, one of the dangers of a player who has lost on a lane, he may lose the left-hand lane also. Pete, although very young, extremely experienced, it's so important. His wife, Dee Dee, looks on to keep tuned in here on the left-hand lane in case he hits the right-hand lane.
And Dee Dee and Pete's daughter, Nicole, right there at the left.
Tremendous pin action. Pete Weber undoubtedly has one of the greatest strike balls ever to come out in the Pro Bowlers Tour. If he can keep it there, he's very tough. Now let's see if Jasnau, who wasn't really that aggressive in his first match, can be aggressive in this Weber match and close him out early.
Big three-bagger.
Jasnau, 32-pin lead, has every ball in the pocket. Strikes in the first and second frames, 10-pin in the third, has put together three more strikes. Chris, he's the only one who's been able to figure out the pair so far.
Now he has strung four.
Sports tomorrow.
There is Pete Weber covering the 10 pin on the left lane in the eighth frame. Running behind our schedule in the seventh frame, he left the four pin and marked. He's trailing by 43 against Mike Jasnau, who has a four bagger shooting in the eighth. His sister, Jeanette DiBiase.
Jasnau with a chance to put the match away.
Happy sister, and of course, a more pleasant look on the face of 24-year-old Mike. What a tremendous comer. He will really make his presence known in the future, Bo.
No doubt, Chris. President of King Louie International, Bob Palin, I was speaking with him just before we went on the air. He said, who do you think will win? I says, if Jasnau gets by the first match, look out. He says, you got to be kidding. I says, this kid has really got it. You watch. Match well in hand. That makes very little difference.
Very appreciative crowd here, very knowledgeable, leaving the 2-4-5-8 as a result of this shot.
Jasnau with about 13 revolutions on the bowling ball. Pete Weber, one of the more powerful balls, gets about 15 revolutions. The 2-4-5-8, Jasnau obviously straight at it, not to give up any big open frame if he can help it.
Pete back up now, shooting in the ninth frame of our third game. The first for Pete, the second for Jasnau. So with the high hit and the split, $8,000 for Weber today, adding to his $76,000 he's earned thus far this year. But the first win of the year is most elusive for this young man. So there is Mike Jasnau, who will go into the final match. The Professional Bowlers Tour will continue after this message. Mike Jasnau looking for his first victory in his young pro career with 10 strikes at 255, Pete Weber's 180. It'll be Jasnau and Jimmy Pritts. 128 started here earlier in the week, and here are other finishers.
Some of the top finishers this week, the U.S. Open champion Del Ballard, Butch Soper right up there, Kent Wagner, a late charge. I snuck a little check in, Mal Acosta bowling great again, Gil Slicker sharp, he was in the Miller's final, Berardi's up there, Shortcut Sam Zurich, Amleto Monticelli, all the women love him, Ray Perez, Tommy Baker every week, Brad Bowling, what a great bowling name, the $100,000 300 man McCourty, McGavro moved up one more spot, Tony Westlake, Todd Worrell, Robert Well, Womack, and some of the other finishes in the top 24. And with me is the wife of our tournament leader, Joanne Pritts. Joanne, your husband wasn't even going to bowl this tournament.
No, he got pretty aggravated last week. He's been bowling pretty well, and but his night blocks have been pretty bad. So he shot under again, and he called Harry Golden and withdrew. But I talked to him, and I told him last week, he couldn't judge on that, seeing what was a split house, to hold on and see what happened, and he ended up cashing on Thursday. So, he felt a little better about it, so I convinced him to come.
A win here would put him back in the Firestone. Obviously, you have to know if he feels confident. How's he feel going into today's match?
Pretty good.
Well, he told me he's going to retire. I think he'll go by the wayside if he wins the tournament today, and good luck, Joanne. Chris, the final match, it's going to be a very tough one.
Okay, and two professionals going for 37,000. $24,000 to the winner, $13,000 to the runner-up. Mike Jasnau has two victories. He will shoot first, going against Jimmy Pritts, recently celebrating his 28th birthday, where Jasnau is 24, looking for his first win as a professional. Thus far in two victories, 18 strikes, and as he did in the previous game, an opening strike. Now here is Jimmy Pritts, Jr., Lawrence, Massachusetts native, living in Manchester, New Hampshire. And everyone is glad that he decided to continue on the tour. Oh, yes.
What a great shot, Chris, on that one. Now watch the action of the head pin. Now, it'll hit with a ball. It'll go all the way to the sideboard and come back across and take out the 10. Watch the action of Jimmy Pritts. There it goes. Bye-bye, head pin. No, there's still some power left in it. Stays in play. He's in the match.
Young man that led five of the rounds here. 5'8", 180 pounds. I hit on that left lane. 3-6.
The man with a very short approach. Well, he rocks to get the weight back on the back feet. Gets a good rhythm. Five-step delivery. Shoulder-high backswing, good deep knee bend, long slide. Releases that ball on the slide with just a medium amount of hook.
Jimmy's first appearance this year. Last year he was fourth in the Fairlanes Open. And here is the young bowler that was fourth right here in the King Louie Open a year ago. Strike up, second frame. Consistency.
Jazz now out to a quick start. As you see, a 42-game tournament, 18 games in the qualifying round. Tommy Baker, who made the top 24, the early leader after six, Pritts took over the lead and has just dominated this tournament. In fact, at one time, he had almost a 300-pin lead. Weber closed down some of that gap, but Pritts obviously ended up number one.
Get a low angle replay.
We talked about 12 or 13. That's 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. When you get that kind of revolution on a bowling ball, those pins have no chance to stand. Pritts under the gun in the early going.
Robbed. 10-pin.
No doubt, Chris. Solid 10-pin. Pritts has the line on the right-hand lane. This is the lane that was the undoing of the cranker players such as Husted and Weber, but Jimmy Pritts will hit this lane pretty well. Ball solid in the pocket, just gets an unfortunate break, as you said, the solid 10. But the key is going to be the left-hand lane. Pritts, can he hit the left-hand lane, is going to be the key to the whole match.
Okay, earlier we asked Jimmy at age 28, you wanted to retire?
Well, last year I had a tough year, and this year started out being a tough year until this week. And I have a wife and two kids, and I had to seriously think about their future. And if I couldn't support them out here, then I had to go home and get a job. And I thought that way, and my wife talked me into trying it one more or two more weeks. And I thank God that she did, because here I am leading the tournament this week.
But he needs more luck here today, leaving the 7-pin. Joanne and their daughter, Amy.
And I'm sure it disappointed Jimmy Pritts. He makes the adjustment on the left-hand lane, hits the ball in the 1-3 zone, drives that 5-pin over into the 4-7 area. We've seen that three or four times today. Nobody has ever been able to carry it consistently except Jasnau.
Okay, the championship match is underway. Jasnau leading by 22. And he just happened, that's his wife, Linda. Lynn happened to have gone to Purdue.
All the smart ones go there, aren't they?
All the good quarterbacks do, anyway.
He was great. Now, here's Jasnau. 22-pin lead, three strikes in a row, fourth frame.
This man has a four-bagger. 22 strikes thus far for Mike Jasnau.
Mike Jasnau with that bright red bowling ball that doesn't look as the same as everybody else's bowling ball going down there. It turns white and red, but as the ball begins to go into a full roll, it drives all 10 pins in the pit. The pins are colorblind, and obviously they're reacting very well to this ball. 32-pin lead, four strikes in a row, championship match.
And then he left the 2-4 after the string of four.
Jasnau coming in light after four strikes in a row, leaves a 2-4 spare. Fairly simple to convert. Now, there's only one person that can beat Mike Jasnau in this match, and that's himself. If he keeps his hand underneath the ball, doesn't try to spin it too much, he's going to be almost impossible to beat.
Okay, back up Jimmy Pritts. Named by his father for the baseball great, Jimmy Fox. So his name is Jimmy Fox Pritts Jr.
And Jimmy Fox Pritts needs to hit a few home runs with a bowling ball right now. He trails by 30.
There's one.
This shot will tell a lot about the match. I don't believe that Jimmy Pritts has as good a shot or trajectory of the pocket as you look at our top five money winners for the 87 season through 2 months. Walter Ray Williams, 50,000 rods out the top five.
Mm-hmm.
And going back, you can see Randy Lightfoot, who's had a good year so far, and some of the other top players. What I'm saying is that Pritts does not have quite as good a shot to the pocket as Jasnau, so he must be perfect on this left-hand lane. This is an important shot right here.
The four pin.
Chris, I had the good experience or bad experience of bowling on this championship pair last night in the last game. I needed a big game to make the top five. Obviously, I didn't roll it. And the same thing happened to me that's happening to Pritts. If you send it wide on 19, the ball skids by. If you try to help it up, such as Pritts did on that shot, it goes high. A very difficult shot. As opposed to Jasnau, who's playing the what we call the deep inside line, rolling the ball very smoothly with a little more power and letting the ball set up in the pocket. Bowling is very much like putting. If you don't properly read the greens, you cannot make many putts. If you don't read the lanes properly in the sport of bowling, you can't get many strikes.
Back striking is Jasnau. Four strikes and five frames. And coming into this game, as we mentioned, he had a total of 18, including a big last game win over Pete Weber, 255 to 180.
There's a young lady that knows what's at stake. Her brother can win his first PBA title if he can just keep striking. Has to keep his hand underneath the ball. Don't be too anxious. There's still four frames left.
And he left a 10-pin. A little body English from the part of his sister as well. You know, both Mike and Jeanette lost their father last year, so mom is watching at home, and a win here today would certainly help her spirits.
You're right about that, Chris. As you see him leave a solid 10, disappointed, part of the game, just don't let this spirit get away. Don't count this young man out. Once again, I said Jimmy Pritts has got the line on the right-hand lane, lane 20 here at King Louis West. He must continue to hit that lane and reach back for a little extra on the left-hand lane to make it a close match. Two very important frames coming up.
Seventh frame strike for Jimmy Pritts, whose traveling buddy, Bob Hanley, will be knocked out of the Firestone today.
Regardless of who wins, because neither Pritts nor Jasnau are eligible for the final man field of 52 in bowling's third jewel in the Triple Crown. Now, Pritts, a must shot. Let's see what he does. He has to throw it perfect. He's making an adjustment on the approach. Hopefully, it'll work. big gamble right here in the match. He's back in it.
Did a deep bow to the ball and to the pins.
No doubt about it. Jimmy Pritts with what we call just a tweener type ball. Not the big hook, not the straight shot. A nice, smooth, even roll. He makes the adjustment, gets a strike. And you know what? Mike Jasnau, his opponent, knows also that Pritts has the line now. Let's see if that affects him in any way.
Eighth frame strike for Jasnau. And he moves to the left side.
Let's see what happens now. Remember we said if Jasnau keeps his hand underneath the ball, doesn't try to force the hook and top it, he'll keep the ball in the pocket. He's kept his speed around 20 miles an hour. He's kept his accuracy around the second arrow real well, but this is the biggest shot of his career.
A five pin.
And he knows what happened. His hand went over the top of the ball. You must keep your hand back in behind the ball to... And here he gets too much spin when he tries to throw the big hook. The head pin goes to sideboard. He avoids the 2-4-5 spare, ends up with a simple spare of the five pin, but he's left the door open for Jimmy Pritts.
Now Pritts with that double shooting in the ninth frame. The shot coming on the right side of this championship pair at the King Louis Lanes.
Absolutely a must to strike in this frame. His chances will be accelerated tremendously if he strikes here of still winning the tournament.
Boy, has he found the line.
No doubt about it. Remember the last 2 weeks, the tournament leader has won the tournament. John Gannett, the True Value in Peoria. Last week, our tournament leader, Tom Milton, captured the Miller Lite Championship. Let's see if it can happen 3 weeks in a row. Our tournament leader, Jimmy Pritts, trails by 10 pins. If he strikes on this ball, the match will be all even last frame.
In the last nine tournaments here, the tournament leader has won six times here at King Louis. Performance by Jimmy Pritts, the tournament leader. We are even level.
Chris, something that has never happened since I've sat next to you in the announce booth for 13 years is a tie in the championship match. Right now, we have a possible tie. Both players are going at a 2:28 pace as we enter the 10th frame for Jasnau, the 11th frame for Pritts. It is set up ripe for a tie match at 227, 238, somewhere in that area.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see what happens.
Imagine that. He has strung five.
You'll wonder why you need experience in sports. This man's been out here on the professional bowlers tour for 5 years. He struggled through six frames, could not even come close on the left-hand lane, maintained his composure on the right-hand lane, made the adjustment on the left-hand lane in the eighth frame, and now he's in a position to at least lock himself into a tie in regulation. What a comeback.
His wife, Joanne. In a row at the very end, and a 2:38 for the husband of that lady and father of that young lady.
Straight arrow right into the hole. Jasnau coming up on the right-hand lane. Pritts finishes with six strikes in a row, 2:38. He cannot be beaten in regulation. Jasnau has not missed striking. He struck here in the second, the fourth, the sixth, and the eighth frame. He has not missed striking on this lane today, Chris. That's the first time he missed striking all day.
Right. slid by, leaving the 1-2 sleeper eight. That's a toughie. After winning two matches impressively. But the comeback of Pritts.
Woo, tremendous. Mike Jasnau, 11 strikes in a row on that lane, and just heartbreak in the 10th.
That's right, on a 2-14 for Mike Jasnau. He was fourth here last year. This year is number two behind Pritts, the winner. The Professional Bowlers Tour is brought to you by Seagram's Wine Coolers. Everyone a champion. By True Value Hardware Stores. True Value more than just a name. It's their way of doing business. And by Wendy's, home of hot and juicy hamburgers.
You know, I always wondered, why does Miller High Life come in a clear bottle? Boy, did I ever find out.